Today we celebrate the third Sunday of Lent. On behalf of our clergy and staff, we thank you for being with us this morning as we lift our body of Christ wherever you may be. Those watching from home, please remember you are welcome to participate along with us through our digital worship page found on the Facebook page. For those who would like to listen to this morning's Mass in your cars, our radio station is FM 104.1. We will begin our Mass in just a few moments.
Please stand and direct your attention to the back of the church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
As we prepare to celebrate the mystery of Christ's love, let us acknowledge our failures and ask God for pardon and strength.
I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I've done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
We stand. Let us pray. O God, author of every mercy and of all goodness, who in fasting, prayer, and almsgiving have shown us a remedy for sin, look graciously on this confession of lowliness, that we who are bowed down by our conscience may always be lifted up by your mercy, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading
from the book of Exodus. In those days, God delivered all these commandments. I, the Lord, am your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, that place of slavery. You shall not have other gods besides me. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not leave unpunished the one who takes his name in vain. Remember to keep the holy. Remember to keep holy the Sabbath day. Honor your father and your mother, that you may have a long life in the land which the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his male or female slave, nor his ox or ass, nor anything else that belongs to him. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in hope of the glory of God. And hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For Christ, while we were still helpless, died at the appointed time for the ungodly. Indeed, only with difficulty does one die for a just person, though perhaps for a good person, one might even find courage to die. But God proves his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord.
Jesus came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of land that Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. Jesus, tired from his journey, sat down there at the well. It was about noon. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How can you, a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink?" For Jews use nothing in common with Samaritans. Jesus answered her and said, "If you knew the gift of God and who is saying this to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, we don't even have a bucket, and the cistern is deep. Where then can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this cistern and drank from it himself, with his children and his flocks?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I shall give will never thirst. The water I shall give will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me some of this water, so that I may not be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come back." The woman answered him and said, "I do not have a husband." Jesus answered her, "You are right in saying, 'I do not have a husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband." "What you have said is true," the woman said to him. "Sir, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you people say that the place to worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Believe me, woman, the hour is coming when you will not worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. Your people worship what you do not understand. We worship what we understand, because salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when true worshipers will follow the Father in spirit and truth. And indeed, the Father seeks such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah is coming, the one called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us everything." Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one speaking with you." At that moment, his disciples returned and were amazed that he was talking with a woman. But still no one said, "What are you looking for?" Or, "Why are you talking with him?" The woman left her water jar and went into town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me everything I have done. Could he possibly be the Christ?" They went out of the town and came to him. Meanwhile, the disciples urged him, "Rabbi, eat." But he said to them, "I have food to eat of which you do not know." So the disciples said to one another, "Could someone have brought him something to eat?" Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of the one who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say, 'In 4 months the harvest will be here'? I tell you, look up and see the fields ripe for the harvest. The reaper is already receiving payment and gathering crops for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper can rejoice together. For here the saying is verified that one sows, another reaps. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the work, and you are sharing the fruits of their work." Many of the Samaritans of that town began to believe in him because of the word of the woman who testified, "He told me everything I have done." When the Samaritans came to him, they invited him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. Many more began to believe in him because of his word, and they said to the woman, "We no longer believe because of your word, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world." The Gospel of the Lord. Sorry, I was thirsty. I had to take a drink. That was 3 pages. When my family first moved out to Ventura County in 1967, we lived in rural area. We were south of Camarillo here. And when you got off the Ventura Highway at that time, it was not the Ventura Freeway, it was the Ventura Highway. It did not yet become a freeway this far north. You made a right off the freeway and you went down the road, and about half mile down the road, there was a grate that went across the road. And it was steel pipes about this big in the grate. It's called a cattle boat. And so the cattle could not get onto the freeway. That was to stop the cattle from coming up. About another mile and a half down was where we lived. It was actually a housing tract. You couldn't call it suburbia. It was rural. We had a school and a park. We had no police department. We had no fire department. There were no stores there. So anytime you wanted to go get groceries, you had to travel. You couldn't walk to the store. I was 6 years old at the time, and I had already started exploring things prior to moving in. So I started exploring the area. We were surrounded by hill country. During the was spring, the shepherds would bring sheep, and they would graze on the grass that was growing on the hills and everything else. Easter morning, the shepherd would actually bring them down the street with the bells and everything else. It was really something to see. But I started exploring the country. And I would get up in the morning, and I would grab my faithful, trusty friend, Ferguson, my Labrador. She was about 4 years old at the time. And we would take off, and we would go, and we would explore. And at first, it was just an hour or two. And as time went on, it got to be longer and longer and longer. It got to the point where I had my Army Man canteen on my side, along with a satchel with a couple of peanut butter jelly sandwiches and some fruit. We didn't have fruit snacks at that time. You know, I'd take an apple or an orange or some bananas, whatever was on the counter. And what I realized is the longer I was out there, the more I needed water. Well, as I shared with you, this was cattle country. I discovered where the ranchers had water. They had these big galvanized water tanks for the cattle. But the cattle were the only thing that were eating there. You can see deer tracks, you can see coyote cat tracks. There were all kinds of other tracks there. But what there was is there was a pipe that came out of the ground, and it kind of elbowed over, and there was always water running out of it into the trough. And as a child, I didn't understand why that water was running into the trough. It wasn't until I got older that I discovered the reason why. So I would fill my canteen there, and I would be out there all day. I would leave about 8 o'clock in the morning. When I'd get up, and I wouldn't come home until 5 or 6 o'clock at night, it was dinner time. Now, this was during the summer. Now, I feel sorry for my mother. Not that she was worried. Neither of my parents were worried. And parents, I'm sorry, if you did this with your kids today, you'd get thrown in jail. You can't do this anymore. But my poor mother, I brought home frogs, toads, turtles, lizards, snakes. I even brought home a tarantula to kill at one point. Because during the summer, if you had a thunderstorm, the tarantulas would come out. And so I would even bring a couple of those home every once in a while. But my poor mother, she'd go do laundry, and I had forgotten when I got undressed that evening that I had put maybe something in my pocket. And you know, she would pull the laundry out, and a lizard would come out, or a frog, or a toad. The turtles, they were actually water turtles that the ranchers had brought out to keep the vegetation from growing in some of the farms that they had. Now, in our gospel story, that's not the water that Jesus is telling us about. He meets this Samaritan woman on his journey. Even the journey that Jesus took that brought him into the town of Sychar, he shouldn't have been taking that road. He should have gone the long way around. Because as the woman tells Jesus as they start to converse, why are you talking with him? We have nothing in common. About 700 years prior to Jesus and the woman meeting, the Assyrians invaded Samaria and had taken over, and the Samaritans had interbred with the Assyrians, and so the Samaritans were no longer considered clean, because they were no longer a pure form of the Jewish religion, or the Jews, I should say. Now, ironically, a few hundred years after that, Babylon invaded the Israelis, they were Judea, and the Jews were taken into captivity. And once they put them into slavery, once they were released, they rebuilt the temple. And the Samaritans actually offered them help. The Jews told them, no, you are not clean. So that's where this rift comes between the Samaritans and the Jews. Now, all along, if you listen to the story, as this is going on, Jesus is fishing. He tells her about the water. He reels her in slowly as he's throwing the line out. And he finally catches her when he starts to tell her about her husband. Or husbands, I should say. And that's when he describes the living water. The water that he can give. The Holy Spirit. That's what Jesus is telling us about. He's telling her about the Holy Spirit. He's not telling her that she needs to drink water to get what he's going to give her. She comes to believe who he is. She goes into town and shares it with the others who come to believe. They come out, they meet Jesus. He spends two more days there with them. This woman, because of her belief, not only started to believe in the Holy Spirit and the life-giving water that Jesus gives us through the Holy Spirit, but the entire town. This one meeting that Jesus had with this woman at the well converted the whole town. That Holy Spirit is something that we all have also. That we as Christians, we as Catholics, it's something that has been given to us. But we need to nourish it. Not only do we need to nourish it, but we need to give it back to other people. It's a gift that's been given to us, and it's with all gifts that we receive from God and from Jesus, we need to give back. How do we nourish it? Through prayer, through good works, through talking to friends, helping people. That's all the ways that we give it back. Now, as I shared in the beginning about the water always pouring into the water out in the field, out in the ranch country for the cattle, I realized as I got older that that water needed to run. If it didn't run, the water inside the watering trough would go stagnant. Anything that came, whether it be cattle, animals, or myself, would die if they drank stagnant water. The living water that Jesus Christ gives us is no different. If we don't nourish and share that living water that Jesus has given us, it will go stagnant. It will die inside us. As we grow, as we learn, as we mature in our journey home, that living water is to be used to get closer to Jesus, to get closer to our friends, and to help all of those around us.
This time I invite the elect to come with their godparents forward. My dear brothers and sisters, these elects are in their final period of preparation before entering the waters of baptism. Today, they celebrate a scrutiny which will help heal any spiritual weakness or sinfulness and strengthen all that is good and upright within. I invite you now to pray in silence for a few moments as they search their hearts. Elect of God, you have just heard in the gospel about the Samaritan woman thirsting for living water. With a spirit of repentance, you are invited to reflect on your own thirst for the living water which Christ offers. Bow your heads and pray. Let us stand and continue our prayer for these elect whom the church has confidently chosen May they successfully complete their long preparation and at the Paschal feast find Christ in his sacraments.
And like the woman of Samaria, our elect may review their lives before Christ and acknowledge their sins. We pray to the Lord. That they may be freed from the spirit of mistrust that deters people from following Christ. We pray to the Lord. That while awaiting the gift of God, they may long with all their hearts for the living water that brings eternal life. We pray to the Lord. That by accepting the Son of God as their teacher, they may become true worshipers of the Father in spirit and in truth. We pray to the Lord. That they may share with their friends and neighbors the wonders of their own meeting with Christ. We pray to the Lord. That those whose lives are empty for the want of the Word of God may come to the gospel of Christ. We pray to the Lord. That all of us may learn from Christ to do the Father's will in love. We pray to the Lord. That those who have died may rest in the peace of the Messiah, especially George Littlejohn, Samuel Perdomo, Thomas Sapinski, Dolores Dishazy, and Robert Maldonado. We pray to the Lord. For all those intentions that we each hold deeply within the silence of our own hearts. We pray to the Lord.
O merciful Father, through your Son, you revealed your mercy to the woman of Samaria, and moved by that same care, you have offered salvation to all sinners. Look favorably on these elect, who desire to become your adopted children, through the power of your sacraments. Free them from the slavery of sin, and for Satan's crushing yoke, exchange the gentle yoke of Jesus. Protect them in every danger, that they may serve you faithfully, in peace and joy, and render you thanks forever. Amen. As I lay hands on these elect individually, I invite you to please be seated and continue praying with them in silence. Elect of God, please kneel now and continue to pray as I ask God to bless and protect each one of you. Lord Jesus, in your merciful wisdom, you touched the heart of the sinful woman and taught her to worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Now by your power, free these elect from the cunning of Satan as they draw near to your fountain of living water. Touch their hearts with the power of the Holy Spirit that they may come to know the Father in true faith, which expresses itself in love. For you live and reign forever and ever. My dear elect, although you cannot yet participate fully in the Lord's Eucharist, Stay with us as a sign of our hope that all God's children will one day eat and drink with the Lord and work with the Spirit to recreate the face of the earth.
Sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Be pleased, O Lord, with these sacrificial offerings, and grant that we who beseech pardon for our own sins may take care to forgive our neighbor. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with
lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For when he asked the Samaritan woman for water to drink, he had already created the gift of faith within her. And so ardently did he thirst for her faith that he kindled in her the fire of divine love. And so we too give you thanks, and with the angels, praise your mighty deeds as we have planned. Give life to all things and make them move and you never cease to gather people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given for you. And giving you thanks, he said a blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of it, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your Pilgrim Church on earth with your servant Francis of Heaven, Jose, our bishop, his auxiliary bishops, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion and merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you, at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and saved from all distress, as we await the blessed heaven and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, said to the apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer one another a sign of the Lord's peace.
Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him, who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter my room, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. For those who cannot be with us physically, please join me now in an act of spiritual communion. My dearest Jesus, I believe in your presence in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Thank you. Let us pray. As we receive the pledge of things yet hidden in heaven and are nourished while still on earth with the bread that comes from on high, we humbly entreat you, O Lord, that what is being brought about in us in mystery may come to true completion through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We have a few announcements. The Knights of Columbus are outside again selling tickets for their St. Patrick's Day drive-through dinner. Get your tickets early to receive a discounted price. Next weekend, we will hold the quarterly St. Vincent de Paul collection. You can bring your donation in a pre-marked envelope with a check made payable to St. Vincent de Paul Society or contribute to them directly next week. Any donation is very much appreciated, especially these days when the need is so great. Thank you. Our Lenten prayer service will be live streamed tonight, March 7th at 7 p.m. on the Facebook page. Please join Music Ministry for this opportunity to continue your Lenten journey through music, readings, and silence. The prayer labyrinth in the small grass area of the parking lot is available anytime for quiet prayer. We also hope that you have set up a prayer corner in your home and are taking time for daily prayer, as Deacon Andrew beautifully to us, just as he needed that water when he was young, and all the animals. A lot of times, sometimes we get consumed by other water, whether it's the uncertainty of the future, what's going to happen with our finances, what if this doesn't happen. But what Deacon Andrew reminded us is the living water that we truly need and our soul needs is the Holy Spirit of God. So as you pray in that prayer corner, really meditate on that, especially this week. Now bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Direct, O Lord, we pray, the hearts of your faithful, and in your kindness, grant your servants this grace, that abiding in the love of you and their neighbor, they may fulfill the whole of your commandments. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our celebration is ended. Go forth in peace, glorify the Lord by your lives.
Thanks be to God.
Have an awesome Sunday.